Lord Jesus, you are mighty God and Prince of Peace. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You are Son of God and Son of Mary. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are the Word made flesh and splendor of God. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins. Forgive us your last time.
Amen.
Rise up in splendor, Jerusalem. Your light has come. The glory of the Lord shines upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, and thick clouds cover the people. But upon you, the Lord shines, and over you appears his glory. Nations shall walk by your light, and kings by your shining radiance. Raise your eyes and look about. They all gather and come to you. Your sons come from afar, and your daughters in the arms of the nurses. Then you shall be radiant and open sea. Your heart shall throb and overflow, for the riches of the sea shall be emptied out before you. The wealth of nations shall be brought to you. Caravans of camels shall fill you. Dromedaries from Midian and Ephraim, all from Sheba, shall come bearing gold and frankincense and proclaiming the praises of the Lord. The word
thanks be to God.
Through the word.
Really?
Why is there any good? See, this idea that life should be good, and then tragedy is the exception that breaks in, that disrupts the status quo, it's a very new idea. That's not how human beings saw the world or of life. Thousands and thousands and thousands of years. No. Human beings knew life was short. It was uncaring. It was cold. It was brutal. And good things were the exception. And you see this in ancient thought. That time itself was this endless cycle that just repeated itself. There was no goal, there was no end. Sometimes things were good, most of the time they were bad. There's no meaning to it. And the meaning they did find, what they did think of the world, you can see in how they made their gods. You can see what they thought of the world, but who their gods were. You think of the Greek gods. He's angry, childish, brutal, deceptive beings that fought, that warred, that abused humanity, never really cared for humanity. What is your life like if those are the gods you make? If those are the gods you look to and pray to and offer to? And the philosophers had a different kind of God. Maybe even he was good. But he wasn't loving. He was not caring. All powerful, yes. That's about it. That's how people saw the world, and with good reason. Because that was their experience. The good was the exception. Except all of that is not the truth. History is not this cycle. No, we know differently. That from the very beginning of history, God created things good. And why is the world evil? Why is it broken? It is our fault. Beginning with our parents, Adam and Eve, but we do know better, even though we know so much more than they did. We continue that evil and that violence. And sometimes it surprises me that we think we deserve better. And we're the ones who cause so much hurt amongst ourselves, even ordinary people. But despite all of that, God would not abandon humanity. Despite all of that, he continually reached out to us and offered covenant after covenant. And he did that in a particular way with the Jewish people. He wanted God and humanity to come back together, back into harmony. But we know from the scriptures time and time again, they screwed up. Even though God was faithful, they were unfaithful. And so this deep longing in the human heart, this desire that life have a meaning, this gut instinct that death, that's not right, death shouldn't happen, death is wrong. This desire to meet the divine, to have things make some more sense, and for life to have meaning and purpose. Desire was still unfulfilled until the birth of Jesus Christ. And this changes things radically. Because that union between God and man, back to our Creator, back to the love that made us, it happens in the most profound way in Jesus, who is truly God. Is truly there. And that mission of Israel
that Israel was meant to be a light to the nations, to show them who God really was and is, to show them the way they're meant to live, that mission. But they often failed at it. Becomes completed in Jesus Christ. And not only that slavery to sin that we all belong to, a tendency to do evil, to make the world worse, even from that, God freed us. And more than that, it's hard to believe, it's not even thinking. But what Jesus Christ did for us, what Jesus Christ does for us, is far greater than anything that Adam and Eve could have dreamed of. Because Adam and Eve were created by God. They were not children of God. But we, by our baptism, are. And so that hope, that longing for the entire world, it's symbolized, it's wrapped up in the feast day that happens today. We, the Gentiles, that longing in our ancestors' heart, we see it in the wise men, searching after God, and finally seeing the star, the invitation, the hope that there's something more to life. That God has not abandoned us. They come and meet their God, who fulfills all the prophecies, all the promises. But it's funny how it happens. It's quiet. It's small. This God who is so huge and so powerful, he became this little child. And even though all the nations, all the kings, should have screamed toward Jesus, being held by his mother Mary, there were only three. And in that three, we see what God is doing and has done. There's a reason why we still have these Christmas decorations up. Because it's still Christmas. We're still in the midst of that joy that we do have. We do have God. And if what I'm saying about that, that you have God, somehow falls flat in your hearts, I am sorry. Because even though you've been given the great gift of baptism, you and I, we often reject it, put it aside, and don't believe it, and leave it like a present wrapped up, wasting away. Even though God has given you everything. And so we turn again today to the Christ child with the Magi. Offer God something. Don't hold on to that doubt. Because here's the thing. That great promise fulfilled in this small God-man. So often we sit in the pews and think that God is too big for us. That God is a God for the saints. That we are not special enough to earn his attention. But God loves you so much that he will become utterly vulnerable to you as a child. Brothers and sisters, each and every one of us is called not just to be a good person. Because just to be a good person is terribly boring. Terribly average. You can be an atheist and a good person. No. God has called you to be a saint. Not just to tolerate evil, but to love them. To live a life of love. That's the gift he offers you and I. Everyone else. Even though God is far surpassing us, far greater than us, he's not too big. And as vulnerable as he was in that manger, how crazy it was that these kings, these wise men, bow down and worship this little child. In a few moments, we will do better than they. Something that looks far more crazy, far more absurd to the world. But we will kneel down and worship what looks like bread and wine. It is truly the body and blood, soul and divinity of Jesus Christ. God is not too big for you. He makes himself even more vulnerable on that altar so that you can remember his love. Be strengthened by his very self to stop living just the life of a good person and start living the life of a saint. Today is Epiphany. May we worship our great God made small, losing none of his greatness, even better than the major.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear our prayer.
Let us now conclude by praying our parish prayer, found on the back cover of the hymnals. Lord Jesus,
hold us in your heart. Hear your heart and soul. Thank you.
number 446 in your hymnal, A Little Town of Bethlehem.
Christ our Lord.
Amen.
To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unnumbered sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant our peace, guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and David, our bishops, and all those who hold to the truth, and all the Catholic beings of the faith. Remember, Lord, your servant, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, for they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, the redemption of their souls in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living in truth. Celebrate the most sacred day, on which your only begotten Son, eternal with you in your glory, appeared in human body, truly shared our flesh, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, either in Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, Andrew, Linus, Venus, Clement, Sixtus, Cordelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Misogynus, John and Paul, Apostles and David, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things you may be defended by your protective help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, God in your whole family. Order our days for your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation, and count among the flock of those who have chosen you. Be pleased, O God, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect, make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands. With eyes raised to heaven, he, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which we poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of the Holy Angel to your altar. divine majesty, so that all of us, through this participation at the altar, receive most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants, who have gone before us with a sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, for all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, open your love and mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Clyde, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, to their company, not blame our merits, but grant us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom we continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and so go with us.
You're the lifted that living here, O Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him. takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Thank you. Amen.